And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. You can't.
Why do you think I came all this way?
Hi everybody, so welcome to GOT Academy's Game of Thrones prediction summary. Gonna go over everything that happened in the final episodes of Game of Thrones and see how GOT Academy's predictions stack up. Boom. So basically, most of our predictions are a direct result of the way that we viewed the story. We looked at it as a historical, political story, an epic fantasy story where the world at the end will be different than the world that we met at the beginning. And that the problems that were there at the beginning will have to be addressed, if not solved, at the end. So having placed a story in the end of the Middle Ages, the War of the Roses in England, and knowing what came later in England and in Europe, a decline in feudalism being replaced by an absolute monarchy, a starting of a process that will see the rise also of a knowledge class, of representation first to the lords and then to the people. So the face of all this analysis was Sansa as the Queen of the Seven Kingdoms, and the Seven Kingdoms being united into a united kingdom with one army, with all the institutions under the monarch, the Queen, the Faith, where is the Faith now? Whatever. The Maesters, one army, the Night's Watch will become the basis of a standing army. No more private armies that all the lords have, which was maybe the prime catalyst for all the civil wars that we've seen in these past 8 seasons of Game of Thrones. And from then on, all the pieces fall into place. The characters that have a place in this new world, changing, reforming world, we predicted that they will find their place in the conclusion. So let's go character by character. So Sansa in the TV show was not Queen of the United Seven Kingdoms. She was just Queen of the North. I'm gonna discuss this at more length in our historical breakdown of the conclusion of the story. I'm gonna do that with Dr. Woodcavos. He's a scientist, but a humongous history buff. I'm going to post it on the podcast and also here. But if you're not following the podcast, the links are in the description. Check that out. Loads of podcast-only content there. So very clearly, the conclusion of the story, the world as it is, even though it did not have Sansa there as queen of the United Kingdom and it was broken into 2 kingdoms, it was basically the world that we predicted. I said that the monarch will be voted by the lords, by the high lords. They had like 7 lords. I predicted a massive hall of lords. That's probably for the books. So since they didn't want to give it to Sansa, they gave it to Bran, so they just gave Sansa a consolation prize. Whatever, it doesn't really fit politically. So other than that, let's go character by character.
I'll state my case of which I'm certain.
Jorah Mormont, wrong. I thought he was gonna become the head of the new army. Nah. Brienne of Tarth, ting 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 ting. I said she was going to become a part of the Queen's Guard, Sansa's Queen's Guard, so she's in Bran's King's Guard. Why isn't she with Sansa anymore? I guess her oath is complete. She was able to take another oath. Jaime, half right. I thought he would be Sansa's hand, not die, so that part was wrong. But I did mention that I thought he would become a hero in the annals of history and in the history book of the Kingsguard. It was going to be written that he's a hero and his entire story would be changed and the Kingslayer part wouldn't play as important a part in the annals of history. Varys, boom, burned, boom, call it confirmed. Bronn, nah. Tyrion, okay, that was kind of very annoying. So Tyrion at the end was again a prisoner and again got out of trouble thanks to his words. I couldn't imagine that Tyrion would have just a recurring of the same theme that he has. I did not see that coming, thankfully, because that's kind of a boring arc. Tyrion starts out here, ends up here. succeeds a little bit, fails, succeeds, fails, succeeds, fails, succeeds, fails, succeeds, boom. Gets what he wanted. Okay. I don't see that happening in the books at all. Regrets. I've had a few. Cersei Lannister, I didn't predict the way that she was going to die. I did think that the city was going to burn. I predicted 2 years ago that Daenerys was going to burn the city. We predicted 5 years ago that Daenerys was going to go mad, so we get a thumbs up. So that's that. I also have to say that I predicted that the final shot of Daenerys dying would be in Jon's arms after he some kind of way betrayed her. Before the season, I didn't think he would kill her before the last episode. That was kind of clear. And here we are, a very kitschy, schmaltzy death scene. And for Jon, boom, call confirmed. Before the season, I said he would end up in exile in the West after episode 2 or 3, I don't remember, this season. I said, I changed it up, I said he was going up north, exiled. No king, no nothing. So on that, boom, call confirmed. Arya, before the season, I said she would end up in exile out West. Boom, on that. Bran, I did not really have a prediction because I couldn't see where his story was going. Obviously, I didn't see him become a god king. Okay, Theon, I said he would die a hero and with a sense of accomplishment and redemption. Sam, okay, I thought to myself, he can't become the Grand Maester because the Grand Maester is appointed by the Maester, so he will just write the history of the story. That wasn't such a bold prediction. A lot of people predicted that. But now apparently he's the Grand Maester because we know Sam and we want to see his character at the end of the story. I did think that Arya was going to kill Daenerys and or Drogon, so nah on that. So to sum things up, the way that I see the conclusion is that they actually went to the direction where we saw the story going. But they said, okay, we want to make this conclusion our own. So we're just gonna change things up a little bit at the very, very end without even thinking that that kind of undermines some of the conclusion, historically, politically. All hail and the broken. There were times, I'm sure you knew. Davos, I was wrong about Davos. I was like, Davos is gonna end up retiring. But I guess they needed him for the final shot in the small council just to make us relate to this new government of the people. Maybe, or maybe I was just wrong. So, on that one. So also all the Sansa betraying Jon thing, boom, called confirmed. Even though the conclusion of the story is where we predicted that it would go, and a lot of the very specific predictions are right, I can't say that I feel too satisfied with all this boom, called confirmed, because again, this mix, some of these character conclusions just don't seem to fit with each other. What is going on with the faith now? Why do they still need the faith if they have a magical king? Is he a god king now? Why do you still have 6 private armies in the 6 kingdoms? Why do you still have 6 kingdoms and not 3 kingdoms? Why are Dorne and the Iron Islands still inside the 6 kingdoms? What would prevent in the next election in 100, 200, 300 years, whenever Bran dies, from all the lords bringing to the next election their armies with them and saying, okay, you gotta vote for me now, you gotta vote for my guy. We're gonna talk more about that when we post our historical show review. So it's kinda like a little bit of this, a little bit of that. What most attracted me to this story was the historical and political angle. And this is the chapter that I wrote about in the book, A Thrones Effect. Ooh. So I edited this project and collaborated with 2 Goth Academy collaborators, Noga and Theo, and 7 other YouTubers. There are 10 chapters here. Every chapter looks at the Game of Thrones phenomenon from a different perspective. And you know what? I feel that this is kind of a reclaiming of the Game of Thrones experience. What was kind of botched for most people with the final season, I feel that this book does justice to the Game of Thrones experience and the Game of Thrones phenomenon. So we have a chapter about the historical, political underpinnings of the story. We have a psychoanalytical analysis of the story. We have a chapter about George R. R. Martin's inspirations from other fantasy writers. There's a chapter about how Game of Thrones is an escapist tool that allows us to connect with like-minded people from all over the world. There's a chapter about the redemption arcs, about the deconstruction of the fantasy genre, all kinds of angles. It's really insightful. It's a fun read. And the links are in the description. You can get it in physical book, in an audiobook, or in an ebook. Check it out. And if you have not subscribed, be sure to do that and click the bell to not miss any of our show reviews. And if you want to review the show as well with me on the Got Academy podcast, we have a special offer available until June 3rd. Check out the details also on our Patreon page. Thank you everybody for watching, and we'll see you all really soon. Bye everybody. Hey, so I hope you enjoyed this video, so click subscribe to never miss any Got Academy video about any topic. We do movies, we do TV shows, we do books, and also you can click the bell to get a notification whenever we post a new video.